All right, everyone, we're going to go ahead and get started. Appreciate y'all coming out tonight. Welcome to the Triangle Blockchain and Business Meetup. Tonight we have Al and Eric from BlockLedger. We're going to be talking about leveraging blockchain to enhance the processing and management of electronically signed documents. I know that might sound like a technical jargon, but they're going to go into details about that. Let's go ahead and give these guys a warm round of applause.
Thanks, Rego. So thanks for having us. This is Eric Vaughn. I'm Al Brandt. We've been a part of a startup since late 2016, focused on blockchain. We're located here at the Frontier, up on the third floor. And so if anyone's here and wants to stop by, you can find us right up there. When we got involved with blockchain and started looking at business opportunities, we wanted to focus on the enterprise because that's really where our backgrounds are. We've been in the enterprise network and enterprise storage business for over 30 years. We won't give you a number, but over 30 years. And we've worked together for over 20 years, and probably closer to 25 than 20. And so we've been in the space of providing product to large data centers and enterprise-grade type solutions. So our next turn in our career, in our life, was to try to do a startup, and so we wanted to leverage that enterprise experience to see what we could do with blockchain. And so when we looked at the various use cases around blockchain, you know, we saw a lot of activity in supply chain, government, and all of it focused around digitizing paper-heavy processes, okay, and driving efficiencies out of digitizing manual processes, and documents tended to be at the center of that. And so when you look at supply chain, you're aligning documents to import-export of trade or bills of lading, things of that nature. And these documents then are go through a process of which they start with a standard form, it gets customized, and then there's either multi-party or some agreement of which there's a signing event, and that's legally binding parties to whatever resides on that document. And then if that document can be securitized like a loan, then you have a whole other set of functions around the secure management of that document because it becomes actually a monetary asset. And that's where we see a lot of fit relative to the blockchain space. So from there, we focus very precisely on taking a document process from origination to close and then post-close management. And so what we're trying to do with blockchain is to provide a set of infrastructure utilities that track, authenticate, manage, and securitize documents. And documents associated with deriving value from these functions. The company itself is not looking to be an end user application or solution, but instead infrastructure that ties together a set of players in a space called digital transaction management. It's a large opportunity, and it's a market that is deep to grow very big, and you have blockchain deep to grow very big, and the requirements across both markets tend to be very closely aligned. And so we're BlockLedger sitting in the middle, providing an API and a set of utilities that then leverages underneath it a blockchain platform. Now, from an enterprise perspective, we've made the decision to standardize on the IBM blockchain and therefore are sitting on top of Hyperledger Fabric. And I think, is everyone pretty familiar with Hyperledger and Hyperledger Fabric, or do you want me to do a few minutes on that? Pretty familiar, Cody?
What are the advantages of Hyperledger Fabric?
Well, I'm not here to be like a sponsor and promoter of Hyperledger Fabric.
Why would you be?
So we chose it because they're doing a lot of work around privacy and confidentiality of transactions within the platform itself. And with respect to these use cases and documents, you really don't want to share the specifics of that data across parties that shouldn't have access to that data. It also provides storage utilities that allows you to secure that document with the blockchain but not put the document on the ledger itself. So you don't contribute to this ledger bloat that a lot of people are talking about relative to some of the other blockchains. And so what we'll do is we'll go through kind of where we're focused. Eric's going to then take you through how transactions are processed through Hyperledger Fabric, and then we'll take you through a demo and actually sign a document and store it, transfer it, track it, all of that good stuff. So there's functions called private data or CIDB, and so those are the key technologies that we're leveraging in our use of Hyperledger Fabric.
Questions?
Questions. Okay, so we're in the process of building out a set of APIs that are going to address origination, in which you can add packages of documents or documents to the blockchain. You can then you have to delete individual documents, verify packages, and provide a full historical life cycle of those packages as tracked by the blockchain. In addition, you can provide access rights to users, and so that on the management side, you can write, protect, you can transfer, and all of that. So this is the management side. Then we've done a custom integration with an e-signature provider. The e-signature provider is called OneSpan. It's a rebranded company, which was eSign Live. And so think of that as DocuSign, Adobe Sign, those kinds of solutions. And with that, when you go through an e-signature process, they're tracking events and audit logs associated with all the actions of instrumenting and signing that document. And we'll then take those event logs and audit trails and verify them back to the blockchain. And so we interface into a REST API and just listen for events, and from those events then gather additional metadata to surround the actual document itself with proof points. We then download those documents, do not store them on the ledger, but store them within the private database. Capability is managed by blockchain peer nodes. And so the actual smart contract code or the chain code within Fabric will control the access of users to those documents and that data. Okay. And then we can do verification both within the app or outside of the app. And then what we're working on, I'm sorry, some of this question. Go ahead.
Okay, so the actual documents are stored on like some on the database, some company's choice wherever they want to actually store the documents, but the actual metadata is captured and stored on the blockchain as changes happen to the stuff on that database.
Well, so this is going to be an API that can be leveraged then by a solution provider, right? So you can choose how you want to do that.
Okay.
We would provide a facility by which we would actually store those documents and manage it on behalf of the underlying Fabric platform. And the database is going to be controlled and managed by the peer node in the decentralized network. But you don't have to do that. You can do it on your own database and then just use hashes and things like that. And so then on the securitization side, there's a whole set of regulation around securitizing assets, and this is like mortgages in which so think of yourself going through an origination of a mortgage loan. You have a bunch of documents, you're electronically signing those documents, then you're now registering that loan with a financial institution. That financial institution can in turn package that loan with other loans or by itself and sell it out to a secondary market. Both that secondary market can be investors, it can be packaged in a security offering that can then be sold out to wealth investors and things of that nature. And there's a set of regulation around it. It's called an eVault. And it's the UCC Article 9, Section 105, and that's how you handle something called electronic chattel paper. And it's just regulation around what you have to do with that electronic document from a control perspective. And so we've got some capabilities that we're demonstrating relative to how we manage, but there is then only one unique copy of the agreement, and it's managed as well. And then there is a standard around how you transfer then document an asset from one vault to another, and that's within TOLOC, which is transfer of something. Right. And then there's asset pooling, where I have a bunch of loans, and I can pool and couple those loans and then market them out as a as an offering. And with this, we could implement the actual eVault function is self-leveraging blockchain or provide value-added functions to existing eVault solutions in which they can then take advantage of the increased trust that is delivered through blockchain. So that's a set of APIs that we're developing, and it's what you will see relative to the demo that that we're going to show. So before we get into the demo, then we're going to have Eric come up here and show how transactions are processed with Fabric.
All right, like Al said, I'm going to show you kind of the standard flow of a transaction within Hyperledger Fabric. I'm going to use this picture here to talk through it. And what this is showing is Hyperledger Fabric with two organizations, Org 1 and Org 2. Each of those organizations have two peers, and they're the blue boxes on both sides. And each peer has attached to it a chain code and a ledger. The ledger in this case has got two things associated with it. It's the world state, which is a set of key value pairs that the chain code actually acts on, and it'll read or write those and create those key value pairs as it runs its functions. And so the ledger there is the second thing that's attached. Each org also has a certificate authority. It's used for registering and enrolling users. And in the middle there is the green box, which is the orderer. And its primary function is to collect transactions into blocks and then deliver those blocks out to the rest of the organization in the defined order. Each organization will have an application. In our case, it's a Node.js application. And it talks to the SDK provided by Fabric. And then a user interface to for the application. So the first, to get things started, the user interface will generate a transaction request. That will get sent to the application, and the application will use the SDK to build and sign a transaction proposal. That transaction proposal will get sent to each of the peers for endorsement. In Hyperledger Fabric, the endorsement from a number of organizations. For this case here, since there's only two organizations, an appropriate endorsement policy would need to require at least one endorsement from each organization. So the application will send one to each. Then the peer will validate the transaction, make sure that it's well formed, and send that to the chain code. And in that transaction is usually like a function and a set of arguments. And that function and arguments is what the chain code will run. Chain code will look at the world state, read any values out of there that's required for the function, and then write back and create a write set of how it would change that, that ledger. And then once that's complete, it'll send it back to the peer. Peer will validate that transaction, the transaction results, and then if everything's fine, it will digitally sign that that transaction. And from there, send it back to the application. So at this point, even though the chain code has run, the ledger is still in the same state it was at before the chain code started doing its operations.
I have a question.
Sure.
What if that one, maybe three of those, the other one doesn't. Do you have a backup on that? A chain code, someone who can back it up, or someone, let's say, you need four of those, or this.
So in this picture here, we've got two organizations, and you might only need one endorsement from each organization. So we have two peers, so already they've got redundancy on the peers. And so in this case here, you can lose one of the peers for indefinitely or for a short period, and everything is still working. You'll still be able to endorse and run transactions. Is that what you're doing? So then the application will take the endorsements from the peers, and validate that everything's okay, well-formed. And it can also validate the endorsement policy. And in this case, you would need at least one endorsement from each organization to be valid. Or the application could just pass it on and let the endorsement get validated by the peers later. And then once everything's fine, then we'll send the transaction to the orderer. The orderer will take and start to collect transactions. And they'll collect transactions until the timer expires, and in our case, we've left it at the default, which is 2 seconds. Or if the block fills, and the default again, we've got left it set at for 10 blocks. And then the orderer will send that block out to each of the peers. The order, it's not really validating these things. All it's doing is getting the transactions into a defined order and keeping the blocks into a defined order, and then delivering those blocks to the peers. Once the peer has the block, it will go through each transaction, and it'll validate the transaction, make sure that it's properly endorsed. It'll make sure that the endorsement policy has been met. And then it will go and look at the world state to see if anything has changed since the last transaction. That's the question. Since the chain code ran its simulation. If there's no changes in either the read set or the write set, then it'll go ahead and update the world state to the new values that the chain code came up with. And then mark that transaction as valid in the block. We'll go through each transaction in the block, marking them as valid or invalid. And once that's all complete, it will add that new block onto the end of the blockchain, traditional blockchain. So then once it runs through all those, it will notify the application that the transaction has been completed and that whether the transaction was valid or not.
Questions on how transactions are processed within Fabric? All right.
So for the demo, the configuration is a little different than what I used for the previous. We have 4 organizations built. We each have 2 peers. And then we've got a Node.js application using Fabric SDK. And then the UI is based on AngularJS and Bootstrap. Bottom here is the eSign by signature service, which will be sending the notes and responding to any questions.
Oh, question.
Sure.
Is there a limitation on the amount of pages in the document?
So there will be limitations on size of the document, and it's on the order of 1 megabyte, maybe up to 10 megabytes.
So, but that's with using the Fabric capability of storing the document. So you could choose to use your own database and your own store, which would then be driven by any limitations associated with that and not with the blockchain platform. So it all depends how you want it. So for the demo, what you have to remember is this is a private permission blockchain. So when you think of private permission blockchains, you're thinking of a consortium of business partners. Within that consortium, you have organizations and you have participants within an organization. And so we've implemented, through our software, simply a UI to provide membership services for these participants. And so within this, we'll have 4 participants. Me, myself, I'll be in Org 1. We'll have, we'll have participant called Auto at US Bank, and so that will be where we transfer the loan to. We'll have investors, so we can then transfer that loan out to an investor pool, and then we'll have an auditor, and it will provide read access to an auditor residing off in Board 4. And so what we'll do is we'll establish an auto lease between two parties. We'll use the e-signature software to instrument that document. We'll send that document out to the parties to sign, electronically sign. All while, we'll be tracking this activity with blockchain through the REST API of the e-signature application. Okay. From there, we will have the package signed. The documents will then be, quote, deposited to the blockchain. Can verify that package from an authentication perspective. The documents are obviously hashed and stored relative to the ledger, but then the actual physical document will be stored on the side database managed by the peers. We will show the ability to add documents to it, transfer, so on and so forth. So that will be the demo. So let's go to let's show what we have here. So this is the UI associated with it. And so the UI was put together associated with just trying to show a lot of blockchain-y stuff, right? When you're implementing blockchain, it's going to be implemented in the background. You know, a user coming together for an auto loan and signing an auto lease is not going to know that blockchain is the underlying technology that's going to be securing this document, and that is going to then allow their loan to be securitized out and sold into a secondary market. So don't worry about the UI as lacking in sexiness. This is only to show off blockchain stuff, okay? So what we have is a bunch of packages. This is under the user Al Brand at blockchain at blockledger.com. We've got I'll go down here to the Sally Jones mortgage. In the Sally Jones mortgage, we have a set of documents, warranty deed, truth in lending, so on and so forth. It has already gone through a lot of activity. And so here's the history associated with this package. And so it started with an add package function, and then we updated the access control. When we updated the access control, we gave read privileges to an auditor on Org 2. Okay? Then here we added a doc to the package. So let's go up here and see our docs. We have four docs, and then we added a document to the package, and we added this risk evaluation form and audit assessment form to the package. And so we're tracking all of the history associated with what an institution is doing with respect to the package, and then would be able to authenticate back out the various state at any given time. We added another document, so now we should have seven. We added this standard North Carolina form. Then we deleted the document and then did write protect. Okay, so we tracked the full history of any of the action that takes place with documents that are deposited onto the blockchain itself. We could add a package, we could verify packages, so on and so forth. Let's go back here and now let's do this BMW auto lease. So we've got a sandbox associated with the eSign Live e-signature solution. And so what we have is a draft, and we will go take a look at that draft. And so here it is. So this auto lease consists of a consent form, and usually all e-signature solutions have a consent form, which is basically you consenting that electronically signing it is you legally accepting the terms associated with the agreement. Then we have the auto lease BMW. We have two signers, myself, then Eric Vaughn, and Eric Vaughn is going to be the borrower or the owner of this new AutoLease BMW. And so we have these documents, we've instrumented these documents, and so here's our auto lease agreement. We see that the Bitcoin license plate is taken by this guy named Jameson, so this license plate is going to be Go Blue because Eric is at U of M grad. So he's got some terms here, and then we have click to sign associated with the lessor and the lessee. And so that's instrumenting a standard form for the parties then to come to agreement. So before I do that, let's go back to the blockchain. And if we look at what's out there, we will see event log, which simply has a package create. And so this is what we've received from the signature app through the REST API, through the package create. We look at the actual audit trail, there's nothing because nothing has really happened. We haven't invited signing associated with it. This is simply the instrument. So now we're going to send to sign. This is going to send out emails to both me and Eric to then review the document, agree to terms, and sign. Okay? Because I'm logged in, it recognizes that the guy who instrumented is the guy who needs to start signing. So I'll agree to start signing. And it should pop up. So I have my auto lease agreement. I can just go right down and click to sign. And that now has applied a digital signature to the document and has dated it in my signature. My signing of the document is now complete. So e-sign, here's our date, and my signing is complete. Okay, let's go over to the blockchain and see what's happened. I'm going to just simply refresh. And what we see is all these events. So Eric is logged in. He has set up his signing. I viewed, I clicked to sign, I confirmed. You haven't signed yet, right? You just did, okay? So with that, we're verifying each of these transactions in blockchain. They are stored in a blockchain transaction ID, and we're validating those. And where we have outstanding actions still to validate to the blockchain, they're in the little red X's. Everything that's been verified is in the little green checks. So update, everything is now validated, we have a signed agreement, okay? So let's now go look at our list packages, and we now see that the BMW auto lease, it's got to be refreshed, has two documents, electronic signature and then the auto lease. We can view this. So let's download. And now we'll bring up the PDF that's been signed between the two parties. Here we come. And we have the terms is fully digitally signed and the signers, okay, associated with it. So we have that. I can verify that through the actual e-signature app itself. So if I download through the e-signature app, we're going to get a package, and there it is. And I'll go over here then, do a verify package, and what we'll do is drop these. So we found the package, found the two documents, we have verified through the document hash and the document ID, and where it's stored on the blockchain itself. Now, I can add to this package, so I can so something else happens where I start getting double clicks take place. So I'm going to add a doc, go back. Demo docs, auto lease. So we have a BMW auto insurance policy. We'll add that. Okay, so now I have three docs. Okay. So you can add and build whatever closing material you have associated with transactions with, think of it as loaner notes and things of that nature. And you have the full package, it's secured and controlled through the blockchain and the immutable ledger itself. Then I could choose to transfer this document, and we'll transfer it to auto at USBIN. So now I have a secured loan. It's a transfer out function. And so the way this works is our database, as controlled by the peer nodes, is a private collection of data that you manage. You then put this into temporary space, and it has to be pulled in by the receiving organization in order to accept the transfer. So over here, I'm logged in as Auto US Bank. I will refresh, and I have a transfer in function, and I'll accept the transfer. And so now this asset is owned by Ottawa US Bank. It is no longer owned by Al Brandt at blockbudget.com. And so the package is gone.
Yeah, go. So related to that, so like when we go to verify it, right? Is that a situation where, like, let's say you're logged in as like Al Brandt, you go to verify it? Like, at what point do you find out like who owns it? And, like, the
well, so we're tracking from the beginning what is who owns it, who can have visibility.
So you look at the history at some point and go, okay, this is
So you're logged in and you see you have the various access rights. So on this file, right, I've got I own it in order to and so let's modify this access, and we're gonna add Nord one, and we'll do auto at US Bank. We will do a read. Okay, so now I've just given read access to that file at Auto US Bank, right? So back over here, right? I don't have that up there. I'll refresh, and now I've got read access to that package. Okay? If I try to delete it. Oh, I've got right to text. So I can't, you know, I can't change it. Here's where the actual chain code or smart contract is not allowing you to do this. And so that's kind of key, right? Because if your application gets hacked and it changes credentials at an application level, it's still the actual smart contract code that is controlling and managing the access of the asset, not the application. So it's additional security and trust to the overall solution. So, yeah.
So kind of on that same level, what is your security features for the application itself? There's got to be someone that ultimately has full control as to who is allowed in this private permission blockchain and who has access to read and write. And what is the security around making sure that isn't leaked and opens up everything?
Yeah, that's a good question.
So, you know, right here, we're using user login, like a standard user login, and you can add users with passwords. And then once you add it and the user logs in, we'll go into the CA, register that user with the CA, and roll up. And what that does is delivers back a certificate to the application, and then the private key in that certificate is what's used on behalf of the user to sign and do transactions on the blockchain.
And is that private key stored on the server of the application, or is it stored locally on the users?
So in our case right now, it's stored on the application. It's the SDK, which is going to need that private key.
Okay.
They've got things where you can use HSMs and other databases to store those keys, but for now, for us, we're storing them on the server.
Okay. And one other question, is there a way to get paper documents into this without using the eSign functionality and still retain all the traceability of your application?
Yeah, so all we take, you know, we don't really do anything special, right? We can take in a scanned document and have every, you know, it's just a data file, right, to us. So we can have all of this work on a data file. And so, yeah, that's that can be done. And then, you know, what you're also seeing is people then use the optical character recognition software and pull out unique data, and then process that unique data, and even go through an acceptance process that you actually capture the data accurately and things of that nature. So you can build all of that in to these solutions, and we're seeing various aspects of them.
Yes.
so that's, you know, that's basically what we had and wanted to show to you. And, you know, any questions? Yeah.
So I don't know if the hourly lease example is a real life or if it's just something simple to show, but is that something you envision that somebody would do from home? Or I guess my question is, when car dealers lease you a car, they want you to come in and sit in front of them and sign so they can try and sell you other things. So are you trying to take that process out, and how successful do you think you could be selling it to someone like, to someone where you're going to take away a job or their ability to add?
So a couple of things. There's so the key is that what we're showing is it's the digitization of a process, right? And that can be in person, that can be electronically across a video link. You know, we're seeing electronic notary coming into the mortgage process where you can then close in your living room or in France because you're on a business trip. You know, so you're seeing all of that come into play. And the regulation is starting to be established to allow this, because all of this has to be legally enforceable. Whatever you're doing has got to stand up and be legally enforceable as an executable contract and relative to the actual security, then the handling of that specific document to the regulation that allows it to be securitized and sold out into a secondary market. So it's more the digitization than anything else. But we are seeing, you know, electronic notary hit the mortgage process where you have a complete, fully digital close, and they are doing a recording of that notary session. The notary is online and essentially a video conference with the actual buyer, and you go through an onboarding process to ensure that there's no, you know, undue duress into you acting and things of that nature. All of that is where all this stuff is going, and all that's got to be packaged as evidence that that took place and that and that your actions were intended to perform that activity. So it's all associated with dispute resolution when things go south. Yes?
Can you talk about Blockbuster's revenue model and business model?
Yeah, that's a good question. We might need some help with that. So, you know, what we've been doing is, in blockchain, what I would say is, when you start off, you don't really have a clear sense of where you're going. And so we've evolved over the time. We would expect our business to be one in which we have a subscription API that is part of an overall solution. The solution itself may have hired us to do a custom integration with our API to other third-party software solutions, and we would be potentially paid to deploy, administer, and support the underlying blockchain. So we've got the skills, and what you saw as a demonstration is we've deployed that, we built that blockchain from Fabric and have deployed that out onto an IBM cloud and are maintaining it. And so then that would be another service component of that model. And, you know, right now we are married to Fabric. You know, one could very easily envision that you could have different blockchain platform sitting underneath. This could be Enterprise Ethereum, this could be Corda, it could be, you know, if you want to add additional diversification beyond the IBM blockchain, those could be options associated. So that's how we're envisioning the revenue model. Right now, you know, what we're getting paid for is some proof of concepts and then maintaining a demo capability for clients that want to show this work to provide kind of like the leading edge technology view of where they're going, so things of that nature. In back.
In that model you showed earlier, is Blockledger essentially order in that?
Did you say order?
Yes, or the organizer, you said that when you gave the example of two organizations with 4 years in total, and then the organizer, it was essentially like, quote unquote, minor, I guess you could say, because they're adding the blocks, and here's each organization would be verifying after.
Yeah, so let's talk about, so what you saw is we had the UI, right, which you saw is the browser window. We have the Node application talking to the SDK, and we have deployed chain code on each of the peers, which is a deterministic smart contract piece of software. Okay, that's block ledger's content. Everything else out here is, you consider it IBM, right? It's Hyperledger Fabric. So Hyperledger Fabric has the underlying infrastructure associated with building out organizations, having an order-to-order transactions, having the peer running the actual blockchain transaction code and endorsement policy, the certificate authority of which you're registering users and providing certificates out, and the actual underlying ledger itself that is providing the world state to the overall network.
Okay, in that case, is IBM itself verifying like the history, or like is there some sort of like a federated keys to update the blockchain and like validate its history in a sense? Because like for this is permission to private blockchain, and like what's preventing someone from essentially hacking whatever the institution is, IBM, that's extending this chain, and then changing, implementing a separate history, you know, going 5 days back to change something? Are the peers revalidating? Is it like being hashed periodically into another blockchain? Like, I'm just curious if there's an alternative blockchain being presented to the peers, how do the peers know which one to do?
Yeah, so, you know, that, how the peers, if they get hacked, what gets hacked and becomes unavailable, or is it a good participant on the network, then his endorsements will no longer be accepted by the rest of the organization. But when you're putting transactions in, they get endorsed, and then it's built, you know, deterministically at that point. How they go through, and kind of like, I think you're asking, is there a process where they go through and validate and all that? I'm not familiar with what that process is, but it's part of what IBM is doing is ensuring that the peers and the fabric is all solid.
So that's strictly Hyperledger.
Yeah.
Okay. Then did you have a question?
Yes. What industries are you serving now? What type of clients are using your product?
Well, so we're not doing anything in production sense. What we've done is some proof of concept work, and we're working with clients who two areas. One is, think of someone who wants to provide a lending platform out to a client base, and on that lending platform they want to provide uniqueness relative to their trust, privacy, and confidentiality model of the underlying documents. And so we're working with them to build that type of solution. Another may be looking at providing a full blockchain-based e-vault capability leveraging blockchain and replace your traditional, your existing non-blockchain-based e-vaults to do that securitization of loans. Others are looking simply to enhance existing solutions to add blockchain to what they already do and provide an alternative trust model from what they're currently offering. So they're positioning themselves for the future. If blockchain takes hold, then they can shift to that underlying technology, or if blockchain doesn't resonate, then they still have their existing offering in place. So it's all in this, predominantly in this, what's called digital transaction management market, which is really the digitizing of documents.
So a couple questions within here. Are the industry still so nascent, and companies I've talked to are caught, and these are customers, are caught in between this, well, a lot of blockchain solutions that are coming to them just replicate their centralized database, as opposed to the ones that are in proof of concept now where third parties have to all work together. They don't trust each other, but need a trusted system. And in the past 2 weeks, we've had two major government contracts that I've seen, one by IBM, Australia, and Delaware. Delaware was previously serviced by Symbian, but they both governments chose to go with an integrator, IBM. So one question I have for you is, I know you have a long history with IBM, was one of your decisions for Hyperledger to potentially have IBM as your customer that you would sell through them as an integrator? And I guess the second question is the frustration I guess I'm feeling from some of these customers is, well, if I go with IBM and I'm just beholden to IBM again as an integrator and I'm not getting the full benefit of a blockchain that's a decentralized system that we can work together and not be beholden to one company that's just going to then control my database or my transaction layer. Yeah, like, how do you think about that?
So a couple comments. One is, we'd love to sell IBM, but the reason why we got on board with the IBM platform itself was really IBM's influence in the enterprise, okay? We've worked in the enterprise space a long time. IBM is in all the big banks. IBM is across all the big insurance companies, so on and so forth. So they have tremendous influence in the enterprise. And it's very important with any platform you choose, the platform itself, independent of you, has got to get some type of traction. If it doesn't get any traction, it doesn't matter how great your stuff is, you're not going to get any traction. So it's very important for us to kind of just ride that horse more and more, right? So, but what you're seeing is that there's not going to be a one-size-fits-all across the enterprise. So you're not going to see Hyperledger Fabric dominate the enterprise space in which there are going to be, in which there will be no other entrants. Enterprise Ethereum will penetrate the enterprise space. And there will need to be linkages put in place between the two platforms, between an enterprise Ethereum blockchain platform and an IBM Fabric blockchain, between a Corda blockchain and an IBM blockchain. So we're going to see, interledger protocols develop to be able to take advantage of where you have chosen to implement and now need access to another network. All right, so think of this, and when we talk about central control and IBM, IBM's the one that's really involved with the deployment and administration. The actual control and security of it is done by the participants. And the participants are the ones that are then going to be owning the nodes, processing nodes, and are going to be a part of an endorsement policy that's going to be improved. So you have a vested interest as a participant. You have a vested interest in the security of the network and in this all working in a trust fashion. So, but IBM is more the integrator, meaning it's the one who is working with the participants on the governance model and the overall deployment administration and providing services as opposed to being the owner of the solution. But one of the big inhibitors is putting together one of these consortiums. Consortiums aren't walking around out there that you can just go bump into. You kind of got to, and it's difficult as a startup having influence to pull consortiums together, right? So, it's not easy. It is not easy. And that's why I think you see a lot of activity on the public blockchain stuff, because it's out there. You can be doing business today because you have Ethereum and Bitcoin out there today, and this other stuff you've got to build parties around and deploy, and yeah.
So those are great points, and I was there for the front row of that.
This by the way, is a superstar who was talking. This is John Wolpert. He was, we met with John back in our early days. He was with IBM, and now he's with Consensus.
So yeah. I have this odd position of seeing both sides of this. I
looking at help build one thing and then I'm working on the other.
Right.
And exactly. That's not a vote one way or the other, by the way. It's really a belief, not to make this a soapbox. I've got a real question. But the belief is that private and public a year from now will not be something that would make sense to say. That it's the internet and we do private transactions and public transactions, and you should be able to define the scope of your smart contract between just you and me, and then that should be able to pass parameters between all of us, and then maybe out to a public thing and then back around. And the trick with doing that is how do you avoid race conditions and non-determinism and deadlocks and stuff, right? But what say you to the prospect that what you've got here really will start to shine when you can combine both private and publicness, that you don't wall yourself off in the garden, but you use private transactions when you don't want everybody to know you gave this guy a special price.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and so there's going to be a munging of a lot of this stuff. You know, I would say John's probably would be more optimistic on the pace by which this will all happen than what I would be. You know, I think this is going to work itself out over an extended period of time and is not necessarily right around the corner. Right around the corner is kind of everyone working in their own independent silo. But it is going down the direction John is stating.
So as a practical matter, how would that kind of pattern, how would you evolve into that kind of pattern as a technology?
Well, so one of the things that we're seeing right in and hearing about is, although it's private permission, you still have security risk associated with the actual full trust. And so, it's what, the IBM guys are doing with Clio, where you're doing this mainnet anchoring. And what that is that you're taking a snapshot of your ledger and you're writing it out as a hash on the public Ethereum blockchain. And with that, you can prove that your ledger and your blockchain has not been corrupted up to this point in time. Then you do another snapshot up to this point in time. So one of the discussions we've had with one of the vendors we're talking to is, do we want to do that on a per document basis? Also do a snapshot of that document to the public, and then we can also do a validation process that once again reinforces that there's been absolutely no corruption and no nefarious players within the company. So that's one of the very small steps we're taking to combine these two worlds with this stuff. Yes?
Your latency speed for the block creation, and are you able to stream either audio or some sort of video through this type of platform?
Streaming audio or video through this type of platform from a latency standpoint.
So, right now we're just using files.
Yeah.
When you do a transaction, in the demo you saw, each transaction took 2 seconds to get its validated and stored on the blockchain. So there would be those latencies involved. So streaming, if you want to stream it all the way through, then there may be issues there.
A 10 megabyte cap on block per block pattern. Did you say under presentation?
It's kind of that order. It might be higher, but it's along those orders.
Yeah, and you could tell when Eric was presenting how much work is involved with just processing a transaction, right? And there's a reason for it. It's like Jameson has said, this is not a very efficient database, right? So there's a reason why you're doing it, and it's to build the trust and security around the data itself. It's not the actual latency of processing, because it's very process heavy.
Yeah, so the example was with automotive, you mentioned mortgage, you mentioned insurance. What industries do you see this applying to most, and then what industries do you see picking it up first?
You know, we're seeing a lot of use cases. One of the things I also demonstrated is you know, school diplomas, right, where you're getting a sign-off from your principal and your student deployment, that's providing then a digital proof certificate that you can then provide from a application perspective, transcript. So you can, there is so much going on. You know, I don't, what we don't have is, we don't have industry expert knowledge, right? So, because we didn't come from any of these verticals,
right?
You need to be in these verticals to answer that question, you know, your confidence level of this technology being embraced and leveraged for your industry moving forward. Since we're not subject matter experts, it's very hard to say anything credible with respect to that question.
Sure, sure.
So, I apologize.
Go ahead. This is kind of related to that. So, it comes down to, like, ultimately you can settle this up, right? And you're talking about having an auditor in there. I guess it really depends. Do you see a certain industry that has been more friendly towards this kind of, because you're talking about, like, it's all got to be legally enforceable, right? The idea is that somebody goes in and says, this is a legally enforceable document. I know it varies by state, it varies by municipality, it varies by whatever. Is there, like, a certain place that's been more friendly to this than others in terms of, like, industry? Like, ultimately, like, you know, transcripts probably is a little less intense, so people would probably be more likely to be okay with this versus, like, you know, if you got a regulator that does not read hash, is there any, like, you see any kind of headways in any various industries towards this? I know mortgage is a big one, but I don't even know if regulators are on board with this idea yet.
And, you know, there's a lot of talk, and there's a lot of kicking in tires and things like that. You know, what we're seeing is a vendor who wants to be unique and specialized with their solution by providing greater transparency to what their solution is doing is very receptive. So, you know, if I'm doing a lending platform and I want to open it up to all of my funders and my auditors, and I want that to be a competitive advantage in doing business with me, then you're going to be a lot more receptive to this type of technology.
I guess that was the first question I had before change. Like, so each party would be an organization, right? So you have, like, the actual originator would be one organization. You have the receiver of whatever is your organization, your auditor. I guess how easy it, like, when you plug someone into the system, you have to have them up front, or is it something where you can, like, plug and play with various organizations in terms of who's running the peers?
Yeah, so you can plug it in as you go. You know, we're not very good relative to kind of like embracing an onboarding process with the demonstration. Yeah. So all of these solutions typically have onboarding processes that you know, are very well vetted, and you would have to integrate that onboarding process into the certificate authority capability of the solution. And that's probably the better way to do it.
Yeah.
So, yes.
What happens when, like, for mortgages, for example, if you're the originator and you use the platform and you sell it to, like, Citibank or something and they don't, how do you have any thought about how you handle that?
Yeah, so that's where you've got regulation that, you know, anything that you do electronic can come back out paper. So, and then transferring of one technology vault to another technology is totally standard. So there are standards and regulation around how you can support entities that aren't digital. So. And that's one of the things that all regulation has done, is anything you can do digital, you can push back out analog. Okay, so once you're digital, you're never forced to stay digital. The regulation won't allow you to restrict the ability to go analog. So, yes?
I didn't quite see how much information was in some of these contracts. Like, is there personally identifiable information and, like, user data, like emails and stuff, particularly if they're using that to log in and or sign transactions with? Because it might present an interesting situation if, like, let's say this is a consortium of insurance companies or whatever. Like, if I'm an Aetna customer, I don't have to worry if Blue Cross Blue Shield transactions and customer data, but if we're in like a consortium and that data is actually stored in the blockchain, then somebody hacks Blue Cross Blue Shield and they have all five of the customer data, history of transactions, and updating mortgages and insurance contracts for the entire set of blockchain, or the entire consortium is using that blockchain, each of them have visible permission to look at it and verify it all. So, like, what degree do you see that as being a challenge? And is
So coming into this, when we started to build out some capability, we made some decisions as to what would be necessary to keep private, what you wouldn't have to worry about. And as we learn more and more, you err on the side of keeping everything private, and keeping privacy between parties and not allowing visibility from any other angle to any of that information. So at least, you know, with the area that we're working in, that's what we're seeing.
In that way, is it actually possible to have like just the company and applicant or application or whatever in the customer exchange like privately the contract and then just have the hash of it on the blockchain?
Correct.
And then sign that hash so that nobody outside of that specific agreement?
Correct.
Yeah, I mean, I would add to that the prospect of somebody hacking in and seeing my medical records upsets me, I guess. But the ability to change my medical records is terrifying.
Yeah.
And theoretically, that's what blockchain should prevent. Mm-hmm. The question that I keep coming back to from people in the industry I talk to is, how much verification do you need to actually prevent that? So when I saw your first example, and maybe I misunderstood it, it seemed like there was only two parties that were verifying. And of course, this is a lower level document, if you will. But at what point do you need that kind of that verification to prevent this? And this is open for everybody. I'm not just putting
it out. Yeah, that's a good question, right? Because what makes a consortium broad enough to be effective is kind of the question. And I will guarantee you IBM has a view of that. With all of the different use cases and clients that they've worked with, I would say we don't have enough exposure to answer that with credibility at this point. That's a good question.
That's a concern I've heard as well. Hyperledger is controlled by IBM. Not fully, but it's perceived as such.
Yes.
Therefore, I'm just signing up to another database, centralized database.
Yeah, but that's where I think we're mixing apples and oranges, right? So Hyperledger is a open source community, but IBM would not agree with this, but if IBM was there, Hyperledger would not prosper, would not continue, right? It's heavily developed by IBM. It's heavily driven by the set of requirements that IBM is seeing from their customer base. That being said, the actual operation of the blockchain and control of the data is not IBM, it's the participants on the network. Participants meaning the organizations consisting of the consortium. They're the ones having the vested interest to secure the network and to secure the data within the network. IBM is simply administering, think of it as a private cloud. They're administering an infrastructure and supporting an infrastructure on a break-fix perspective, but they're not the holders and controllers of the data. That is being managed by the technology and secured through the operation of the decentralized parties. So,
and the parties can run their own blockchain altogether too. So you wouldn't have to host it on IBM. You can host it on AWS and run it there. And then
Azure,
you know, IBM is your core Azure, where IBM is heavily involved in the software development, but then the operation
would
be, you know,
you're choosing. Yeah, so you can buy blockchain as a service that is Fabric from Oracle, Cisco, IBM, you know, AWS is a little hokey right now, it's not really solid. Azure, I believe, has got a capability. And so it's just, we as a company could be our business model, right? We're deploying Fabric on this cloud, and we're going to provide administrative deployment and management services. That's a business model. So SAP has one that you can buy. So so you don't have to go IBM. I would go IBM because they wrote the code, so why go Oracle or SAP or anyone else if you go IBM?
And please don't think I'm anti-IBM or anything like that. It's just the questions that I receive from executives are generally, well, then I'm just getting vendor lock-in with somebody else.
Yeah, exactly. And so I'll be honest, right? When we came in, and I watched YouTube videos, I didn't see anyone as old as I am. Okay, so this is back in 2016. Everyone was very young, and there is a lot of there is a lot of resistance to embracing IBM from that new developer community and startup community. And because of, I'm going to just be funneled down an IBM path, and Ethereum provides me all of this broad capability that I can set my own path to. And so, and it's a very welcoming community also. So, yeah.
What kind of security audits are you doing on your software, your API itself? So obviously the blockchain is going to protect anything that gets passed to it to a point. But what are you doing to protect yourself on your side? Are you doing external audits?
So we haven't done anything, but I can tell you that the Linux Foundation funds a security audit for each of the platforms supported through Hyperledger. So they do a very exhaustive, deep dive security audit on Fabric. And there is a report, and it's public. I don't know if it's public or not, but they do a full security audit. They do it on every platform, and it's funded through some third party to do it. We haven't done anything like that, but I'm sure that's something that, down the road would make a lot of sense to me.
Right, so obviously Fabric would be good, but your smart contract written in that CC layer, that's your code that you're writing, and that, of course, is where the holes are going to be.
So right, and so that's all Go language and things of that nature. So, okay. Yes?
The documentation that you have stored in the cloud, are those documents encrypted with a serial number, or do they have a title name?
So why don't we talk about how we identify documents and locate documents and what we can do about
it. So right now the documents will get a unique ID created and attached to them. Each document's hashed, and between the hash and that unique document ID is how we track them and identify them. At this point, I think your question was, do we encrypt them? We're not encrypting the documents we're putting on to the blockchain, but that is something we can do.
The reason I ask is because me personally, I sometimes do searches on Google for PDF files, because I look for corporate logos that I need to use for sponsorship events. If the client doesn't have the original logo to use for print material, I just go look on Google and I get a bunch of PDF files that'll pop up on the searches.
Yeah, so you're wondering if you can do the same search into this environment?
If Google has access to that environment.
So the only people that have access to this are registered users that can do a transaction onto the blockchain. So if you do not have a private key that's known to the system, then you can't do a transaction. You can't read the data out of the blockchain.
Is this central information part project out of Azure? Real-time key or contract participation revocation. The gentleman over there was, if you had the contract participation on the healthcare form, you could just remove your personally identified information in real time. If you have control of the information like that, like X-Road of the custodian is a structure in which you have real-time key revocation of your healthcare records and your PII, so you just remove it and you give access to see it. And we'll actually park out of Azure as a mechanism which it allows different chains to talk and have that organizing mechanism similar to that. I was just wondering if you kind of compare or contrast where you had control over the information in the block at that minute level.
I didn't
So we're not familiar with what capability is available in Azure. So I'm not sure we understood your question. So.
I like the organizer function and the structure. I also love hearing about private blockchain time.
Okay. Any other questions? All right, thank you very much. Appreciate your time and attention.
For those of you who'd like to stick around, we've got open networking time until 8:30, so feel free to talk amongst yourselves.